And also, are parents sensitized or knowledgeable about the value of education? But also look at the quality of teaching. You see, you have children, you have the teachers, they are in school, but also there should be good teaching. But also we look at other factors that actually pull away what we may call the push factor that removes children from school and stop them from attaining the education. And some of these tie into the violence, both in schools, at home, and in communities. And so as an NGO, Joy for Children, that is predominantly focusing on issues of children, education is one of the critical aspects. And sampling the schools we work in, for example, the 60 we work in our work every day, there are so many things we look at. There is one, we look at why children are not going to school. So from the studies that we have, some children don't go to school because of the cost, both direct and indirect costs that associated school fees, a bit of contribution to the schools. There's contribution towards school uniform. There's contribution also maybe feeding at school and scholastic material and so on and so forth. But when you look at some segments of our society, some of these people are unable to afford.
Well, Moses, you've really talked about, you've done research, of course, and you're working in a number of districts. You're mentioning about 60 schools so far you work with. Now, when you come up with perhaps the findings, how do you disseminate them? How do you share them with government? What measures do you put in place so that perhaps they are translated into policy, or perhaps that the people who are concerned can actually work upon the issues that you bring forward?
So the findings that we do through our work, they are majorly shared with the key stakeholders that have an impact on causing the change. For example, we engage with the Ministry of Education at a national level on issues of gender, because much of our work is predominantly focusing on girls' education. So from time to time, we reach out to the Ministry of Education to have a discussion, open discussion about issues that are affecting girls in the education. If we have reports, those reports still we share the same. And also if we have a discussion and we feel that the discussion will need the government input as the main actor, then we get officials from the Ministry of Education to have discussions. But beyond that, we also engage at other levels, like the members of parliament who do the oversight role and the budgeting, and also represent constituencies where much of our work also lie. We also have engagement with them. But also at the local government level, we engage with the district leadership. Most often our meetings, you find we have the RIDCs, we have the LOC5, we have the COW, we have the people from education, all working towards that. And also other civil society organizations, because we're not playing alone, there are other people who are working. So we use that information. Also, we do disseminate that information to parents, who are also eventually some of the consumers of this information, or who make decisions of how education should move. Because if you put schools and no teachers willing to send in children, what is going to happen? So we dissect our environment and then see who has a stake in the learning of these children. And much of our work, from our experience and training, we know that when looking at the education, we're not looking at the blanket, oh, these are children going to school. No, we look at an individual child.
It's now about two years running since the COVID pandemic actually crippled most of the economies in the world, including Uganda, that the education sector world over is actually one of the sectors that are most hit, so much that we even see about 1,000 private schools are actually at the verge of winding up. Now, as the private, as the civil society, because if this was a political season, we'd see a number of statements actually coming from the civil society, perhaps trainings, or perhaps stimuluses. Various reports have come up whereby researchers, and they've advised the government to come up with stimuluses for private schools. Now let's look at the NGOs or the civil society. How do you come in to support in terms of capacity to support the private schools sustain themselves throughout this pandemic?
Yeah, I think one more thing, I think our quality must also appreciate that the pandemic has not affected only the education. But also that we know that because almost a year of uncertainty in education, has left many schools, private ones, struggling. And I think for us on part of the NGO, in my own organization, I'll speak for my own organization, we have supported some private schools, especially in meeting some cost of some of the children that are unable to pay. Mm-hmm. That's the angle that we have been able to use, because some children, sometime they were required to do the boarding, mm-hmm. to stay in school, and the majority of them couldn't afford. So from our part, we use that to support some of the children that are some of the children that are within our care, to make sure we have them, we give them resources, mm-hmm. to be able to go into boarding section. But I think we're not going to look at the issue of giving stimulus to education sector to NGOs. Mm-hmm. I think the government must take lead. Like how it is doing for the businesses and the other sectors, the government should quickly look at that. When you look at the NGOs and the work that we are doing, of course the government has the bigger mandate. Mm. So we support where possible. There are so many people giving in their support. There's the construction of schools. There's putting in the chairs or equipment and whatever is needed in a school. But I think in terms of supporting these schools remain afloat, it should be a wider government plan. It should be with the government plan. And then once that is out, then the civil society can see how they can support. It's the issue that I was telling you, that the NGOs majorly, they support what the government is coming out with. And if that is the need as is now, mm-hmm. we need to again go back on the drawing board. What do we do to support these schools thrive? And this policy discussion we will participate in, and we can still continue participating in, once we have come with a very good strategy. Then NGOs there can come and support. And you'll agree with me that we are not sure when this COVID issue will go.
Yes. Still on COVID, we find that the first pandemic, the first lockdown, we find that a report was released where girls ceremoniously were turned into brides and actually mothers and wives, which is not perhaps your agenda. You are the chairperson of the National Platform for Girls, not Brides. We are getting into another partial lockdown where actually students are home. So how, as NGOs, how are you going to help parents? How are you going to work with parents so that perhaps they don't repeat the same mistakes of seeing this time again their girls not being able to go back to school after the partial lockdown?
I think much of our preoccupation at this moment has also been working to design plans and strategies to again intensify on our communication. Mm. Because what now is needed to reach out to every parent to tell them the importance of keeping children out of marriage, even when they're out of school.
Not only the importance, but also how.
Yes. And so, like it came, all of us would agree that during this time, the lockdown came in as a surprise. Mm. We thought we had done with that, and we're trying to rebuild, and now we hear the pandemic has hit in. And so what we are working on ourselves is to create some messages and also work with our network members in their different districts to see how they can continue supporting parents. But one of the most critical things that we've been discussing, that if we know the community we work in, some parents are not educated, that they cannot sit down and support their learners. But what message we are pushing out, that the parents should allocate time for the children, to say we're not taking you to the garden, we're not taking you to the market, but between this hour and that hour in the morning or in the afternoon should be dedicated for your learning. In the absence of a teacher or a parent who can instruct this child, at least that time should be located to the child to be able to do their own revision, but also to get support from their peers. So for us, that would be the issue. Because we're reflecting, when you go up country, you realize that some of the teachers, of the parents, are not educated. And when you say they sit down and instruct their own children, it becomes complex. Mm-hmm. But what can a parent do? If I'm not educated, I can allocate them to my child. We have seen some children that are loitering or spending hours in the gardens. And we think that if parents are as sensitized about allowing children to study, they shouldn't take this as a holiday. This is not a holiday. It's the same message also I'm carrying at home. You are not in a holiday. So you must read. You must continue with your reading, with what is available, with the material that's available. And reading is not about somebody being in class and instructing you. Even reading some of the constructive books that we have, or literature books, they help shape your mind, and they help shape your understanding and growth. And so that's the message we are pushing out. that can we have these children have the time allocated to them. They're not in a holiday, but we make sure they have that time and they're opening their books and they're learning. And where you can afford to come in and support, that is also very, I think, useful. But then if you cannot, then know that these children have been in class, they have books they have been using in the past classes, they can do the revision. They can revision and the mastery of what they already have alongside other plans. There are many schools that are planning to use digital information or buy some phones and then we can send you content. There are those that are going to get content through the phones. So if you don't allocate a child that time and you put them into other domestic work, then the many children are going to lose out. You put them into planting and weeding and all that upcountry, it's going to be a challenge. So there must be time allocated. Parents should know and understand that this is not a holiday. It's not. Children should be supported to learn, to have the time to learn. And actually, they can utilize the same time probably children go to school and support them to learn, and then they can do other household-related work, maybe later in the evening, when children cannot probably concentrate because they have been studying. Yeah. And also the other challenge I think that also we are facing is that when you look at sending materials on phone, majority of children cannot afford, because we have been getting calls from some of the children that we support that our school wants us to
buy smartphones.
To buy smartphones. But also, well, some may afford, but others may not. But also even those who may afford, they also come with risks that we may not really be prepared for in terms of what we saw in the previous lockdown, children using phones differently. So there are those challenges we are still navigating with, and probably we'll also have discussion with the government to see probably how we can also avail some content to these children, not necessarily on a smartphone.
Yeah, because smartphones or perhaps the technology comes with its own actually challenges, because we saw at some instances, members of parliament were given iPads and most of them were using them for games. Now I wonder for students, actually, these young ones, whether they will really concentrate on the content or perhaps use the phones for other particular activities. Now, do you think we've learned from the first lockdown we have as a nation? Do you see that we learned something from that lockdown?
Yeah, I think there was a lot of great learning as a nation. I saw a lot of policies being adjusted. I saw a lot of discussion about supporting children and making some more adjustments. We saw a lot of mushrooming of online learning or Zoom. I mean, the word Zoom became more popular during the first lockdown and probably didn't even go away. There are some people now communicating through online and all that. So we have learned a lot. But I think one of the challenges that we have, it also comes back to capacity to implement what we think would work. For example, the government, we are a country that could afford, probably putting in technology to support children to learn would have made sense. But now we know what we want, but sometimes there is much of a challenge around the cost of implementing the plans. But there still could be or are cost-effective means of doing that. But also we need some level of organization to make sure that what children are supposed to study now in school, if it can be packaged and then delivered at a given center, that children can reach and pick and go and learn. Because smartphones, you'll agree, some of them who have phones, they cannot even access the power, they cannot access the data to keep these phones running. It's a problem. And also, you're looking at the area where in most of rural communities, that now their incomes are going to be affected. The matoke they used to bring to Kampala, we saw many of our friends going back home. So that means they have no business here. So that means the income at household level in the upcountry is also going to be very minimal, and they may not be able actually to meet the needs of education, like buying data for children to be online, as well as maybe taking phones to the nearby trading center for charging. So those will be some of the challenges. But also you realize that also because of COVID scare, many people may want to reserve a lot of money for emergencies, medical related emergencies, but including the current requirements, wear mask, buy sanitizer, wash and all that. So that we have now an urgent need of meeting the health needs at the moment, which may divert money at a family level from education support.
Well, we find that every other time we have a crisis, be it war, be it a pandemic, actually much burden is piled on the woman and also on the girl child. Now let's look at the intricacies, how tricky it is, or perhaps in raising dealing with the girl child in this particular area, in this particular time of the pandemic, because in the first place, it was a little bit tricky that most of the parents, actually, because they were working parents, they didn't have time for the girls, they didn't have time perhaps for the boys. Dealing with the girls now became so hard for them, so much that most of them ended up being impregnated, ended up running from home, marrying as young people. So how do we now, this time around, the girl child, how do we protect her so that after the 42 days, in the event that the partial lockdown is lifted, then they are good to go?
I think, Mr. Law, will take you back to the statement you used at the start, that the burden of care, like during the issue, the times of crisis, it goes on women and the girls. That has been there, even in our day-to-day life, because of how society has been brought up, that a man, there are certain things that have been put aside for the man and those that have been aside for the women. And so those for women and girls are those that are more tedious, cooking and fetching water and tilling the land and everything. And when you see our brothers ourselves sitting somewhere else doing different things or watching TV or listening to the radio. And so what I think what is much makes more sense now is that to continue our drive for gender equality. It's not needed a round time of crisis, because in terms actually of crisis, we see what we used to do increase. If there were behaviors, if probably they were relying much on women, now you're going to see women do more. Maybe taking care of the sick, or maybe tilling more the land, or sending girls to sell things in their community, or sending girls to Kampala, whatever other cities, to go and fend for the family. And so I think the journey that you're talking about, whether we have COVID or not, we should work straight for gender equality. Somebody should understand that if I'm a man, I have a man and a woman in the home, that all of us must be empowered to be able to provide. Because and even that one is not there, then the other must take charge. But you're a gentleman, you're working in a good office, you have all this money, and your wife doesn't know even actually how that money comes in. The day that you're not there, your children will quickly or automatically be drawn from whichever school they were in to go at home.
And so to the nearest village school.
Now you know your father is not there, you know you are an orphan. Actually, most children are more orphans when they have their fathers die. Yes, that's also maybe they qualify more to be orphans. But you know either way, because the breadwinner has been a man. So the journey that we have been talking about, the issue of talking about ending child marriage and supporting girls' education, is breaking the gender inequality, so that both a girl and a boy can have opportunities to study, can have opportunities to work, can have the same opportunities to earn, and eventually support the family or support the children.
Let's address the issue of school dropouts, which actually during the first lockdown, this was really very visible, because some of the parents really could not afford to send back their children to school. So how should civil society come in here? Because the number of those who are dropping out of school who cannot complete the education is actually increasing day by day.
For me, what also I see that needs to be done, not only probably for civil society as well as government, is we need to increase our education or sensitization of our people. That a little waiting to keep in school is better than dropping out. I'm using an example. So I have children in our own home that threaten to drop out. You see, I thought I would finish when I was 18. Now I may not finish even when I'm 23. But this scenario was giving them, how many years do you have to live? Probably you live up to 80, and now you are 20, you're worried and rushing to get out. And then you're going to live more 60 years, languishing, not knowing what to do. Why don't you be patient for these more 3 years and invest in your education, and then later you can enjoy, you can be more sure how you're going to navigate the remaining, the big portion of your life. So some of the things will need encouragement of these young people. Not even giving them resources, but reaching there and tell them the importance of waiting. And you're like, oh, we're all waiting. You reach there, the office is closed. And what do? You reach there, now you can, personally, I cannot go back to see my parents. I cannot, because they say no cross border. So what am I going to do? I will patiently wait, and they will still the same thing, they will patiently wait. So there's need to communicate that children, as well as teachers and parents, need to be patient until this pandemic goes, and then we resume what we are doing. And I've been telling people that, you know what, in the time of lockdown, of COVID or crisis, you don't need to abandon yourself for what you used to do completely. Mm. It's because you were studying, now you have locked, I'm not going back. No. Hang in there until you finish your goal. And then you can continue. So for us, as from our own organizations and the organization I work with, the issue is also to encourage these children. Secondly, we're also working with the teachers to support these learners. There is a way. During the first lockdown, when they had just opened up, there were children who were not considering not to go back. The teachers said, we're not going to keep you in the same class. We are going to promote you, but give you extra support. So working with the teachers as well on how they can support these children at risk of dropping out, either because of their age or financial stand, it will help keep ourselves keep more children in school. That's the only solution that would work. Let's talk to the children, but also work with the teachers and the parents to support these children to get extra lessons so that they don't feel so much that they lost because of the lockdown.
Now, as education stakeholders, what critical lessons do we learn from this pandemic?
I think for us, I think it's time for us to shift from heavily relying on classrooms. Even when we have a technology of the highest level ever. I have been able to attend some of the high-level meetings around the world. And one of the things that people have been asking, will Africa again lose out in the technological revolution? They say when the agrarian revolution came, we lost out. Industrial, we lost out. Now technology, are we going to lose out? So I think as a government or as a country, we need to embrace technology. We need to embrace technology and see how we can heavily invest in it and stop relying on physical meetings.
On analog systems.
Analog systems and be able to continue with our lives. But away from that, I think it's going to be changed. So the Ministry of Education or the Education should, where possible as well, incentivize some of the investors probably that can invest in the e-learning. Because they may have the resources and the knowledge, but the government may not have. Can we strike a deal that we can start piloting the e-learning even for lower classes so that we can reduce the movements, but also it will also bridge the cost of children leaving school because of distance. That means somebody in school is able to, at home, if they have the appropriate technology, maybe we have the solar and reasonable energy that we can use, then kids can access learning at home. And I think that's where we need to go. As a country.
In areas of extended learning, we find that the community plays a key role. Now that students are back in their village or in their communities, is the community ready for this role?
The challenge that now we have again is the kind of lockdown we have and the messages that are going out that is very loud, or the loudest, is don't mix with people. Social distance, stay where you are, stay in your home. And so that means the responsibility rely in a family unit. So whereas the community may be able to provide some support, that's not there because you cannot easily move and connect. And it's going to be a challenge because some of the children were studying across the district borders. Many of them studying across the district borders. You know, they are even very brand new districts that have been created. They don't have even a very good secondary school or primary school. So it's a challenge. And so we need to focus, I think, our energy now on supporting families to deliver for these children and support in the better way. Maybe the one thing that the community could do, if there is a way to have a centralized, a centralized way where children can get materials that have been, that either have been handled in a way that they may not spread COVID-19, and each child maybe picks a pack, it is sanitized, and then they take it home and do their own reading, I think that might make sense.
So in the next 42 days of the partial lockdown, what should schools do so that they can perhaps they are ready for the reopening? That is, if we can contain and stem the spread of COVID-19, the second wave of COVID-19.
Yeah, I think that now the role, I think, will again go back. How much are we going to condense the syllabus or the the cell bus to make sure the children continue learning. The children have already lost a lot of time, and now they have gone there for 2 weeks, 3 weeks, they are back, and they are required to study a lot.
Actually, some had reported for only 1 week.
Yes. And I think the schools, and I think probably supporters from the Ministry of Education, they need to speak out some of critical topics probably. Critical topics, and condense and make sure these children learn. I have one child who has just come back. They're saying they've been studying from morning up to late in the night and in Saturday and Sunday, which is not healthy, which is not sustainable. You cannot keep kids' minds to be elastic. They reach somewhere and get tired. And he's not about pumping them with learning to understand. So can we summarize or take the rule, the 80-20, that if you concentrate on the 20, then you can even actually cover the 80 that you want to cover. So the school have that task. How do you deliver excellency when you have little time?
Then I can see really time is not our best ally. But now let's look at monitoring the children at home. Let's look at how do we make them productive even when they are with their parents.
I think now one of the things is, like Kavalia discussed, I think, first of priority, I think, should be that children are given time to study. To be communicated, that's not a holiday. It's not a holiday. They have already lost so much, and they should be supported to study, to read what they have, or read, get materials that they can read if they are safe, free from COVID. And I think for me that would be the message. But also on the wider community, then the role of LOC1, this time, or vice chairperson who is in charge of children's affairs in the village, should be very active. That they shouldn't see children roaming in town. They shouldn't see children going in groups, or maybe resorting to using drugs and so on and so forth. There should be a community campaign to make sure that children keep at home.
Now, this is where the LOC ones is, and the executive have to play a key role in helping parents and actually also helping students so that they can really stay home safely, but also continue with their studies. But also the other issue here that we are looking at is that still the linkage, or in other words, the bridge, or perhaps the connection between the students and the and their schools. How should it be?
Now here, I think in the absence of technology, I think it's going to remain very complicated. The schools were locked somewhere in a given district, the children in another district. Away from if they don't leverage on technology using the smartphones or posting work on the website, it is going to remain very complicated. But also I'm not sure, now we're talking about different classes, now there's P1, there's P2, all this primary and secondary and all that. I think for secondary probably and upper primary, for those who can access probably work, and that will be a small section of Ugandans who can probably access something through media on the website or whatever it is posted. But for the majority of the learners, I think the fact that it was abrupt, I think it might be very tricky for the schools, again, to keep touch with their children. We don't have very defined addresses. Probably some children don't have reachable contact numbers. It might be a very big challenge for so many. But I think if the districts can represent, like the education department within a district, represent to pass on information to the rest of other learners, I think it might make some sense. But also if we can take advantage of a legislation, that can we take things to the sub-county, to the parish model now we are talking about, then eventually reach to the village. And this time actually we're thinking that all this lockdown that we're talking about now, and the way we are also in a bit of districts and without a bigger regional aspect helping us, it's a challenge even to mobilize. Because, like I told you earlier, that even some schools, some new districts don't have even schools, even don't have banks, or even don't have some of the major centers to help them. But we are all now in that community. But what can also help here is that the government has structures up to the village. The LOC1, the LOC2 is the parish, the LOC3 which is sub-county, let's utilize those channels, including other supporting aspects like village health teams. This time they can also deliver proper materials for learners if they are available. Now the burden now would be that the government should support, if they can, to provide learning materials for these different categories of learners.
So that an extra cost should not be again imposed on the parents.
Yeah.
Now I can really see time is not on our side. Your parting shot and then we can say bye to the viewers.
Yeah, so for me, one of the thing you, one of the critical points I also want to mention, that this kind of discussion so coincides with the International Day Against Child Labor. Mm. And we know that now children are not in school, then they can easily be recruited in stone blasting, in sand mining, they can be in selling things in markets or town or hawking different things, but also in some crimes, these children can be involved in those crimes within their communities. And so one of the things that probably a message I should give, that there is no better place for children than studying or than being in school. Now, if they're not in school, then they should be studying, doing their self-study at home, being supervised or monitored by the parents. Let's not give our children outside our home for whichever work that is available, because some of the effects that are there are too much. Some children, like you realized, those that were pregnant or sexually abused, many of them happened outside their homes. They're in the corridors of towns and not monitored. These are young children. And we know a society that as soon as a child has breasts, then people think this girl is ready for marriage or for childbirth. So we need to make sure that we have children within our home, allow them to study during this for the 2 days, but also monitor their movements and don't send them out where we are not as adults.
Yes, I might thank you very much, Moses Ntenga, the CEO of Joy for Children and also the chairperson of the National Platform of Girls Not Bride, of really coming to this program, Education Forum, where we look at going back to the principles of Uganda's education. And indeed, it is our collective effort to save our education system, to improve our education system, and also see it function even when we have a pandemic. Manda Kowalo Muzima is my name, saying bye bye.
Anyone seen Bob? Bob? Bob!
Over here.
Where?
Over here.
How did you get in there?
With my Airtel Money MasterCard.
Airtel Money MasterCard? But you don't even have a bank account. How did you get a card?
Well, it's not a card, but it works just like one. It's virtual, so no plastic, and it's safer.
But what are you doing there?
I want to Binance pay the gift, book my flight tickets, renew my Big Click subscription, and order a shipment.
For all things online, the Airtel Money MasterCard. It's not a card, but works just like one. Get one on the Airtel Money menu on your phone.
What does it mean to be closer together? It's taking the last bus home for a surprise visit. Closer together is strangers finding a connection. It's bringing home something much more than a box. It's the warmth of home, or the beginning of something new. There's magic in sharing the things that we love, because it's those things that bring us close together.
There are four understanding this model. Thank you. Dede, who do you think you are? A queen?
Hey, haven't you heard? Get Airtel Chillax bundles and browse like a queen.
Get Airtel Chillax bundles that do not expire and browse like a queen or king. Dial *175# or use my Airtel app.
Airtel, the smartphone network.
This weekend on UBC.
This is a